It's great to be here. Thank you, Pastor Pat, for having me preach tonight to share. As you can see on the screen behind me, we're in a new series on relationships relative to the family, and Pastor has asked me to speak to the subject of marriage tonight and again next Lord's Day evening. Now, if I'm going to effectively teach on marriage, I need to know my audience. So let me ask some questions. How many of you here tonight are married? May I see your hands? It's most of you, okay? How many of you were formerly married? You're now having a deceased spouse or you're divorced. May I see your hands? Formerly married. Okay? How many of you want to be married? May I see your hands? Yes. We'll get the guys and the gals together afterward. And a final question, how many of you who are married wish you were not married? Do not raise your hand. I am a biblical counselor, so I'm going to teach you from the Word of God. In the epistles, there are three primary passages on the relationship of marriage. They are 1 Corinthians chapter 7, Ephesians chapter 5, and 1 Peter chapter 3. I'm going to begin in the first of those three. So if you would, open your Bibles with me tonight to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Now, in an effort for full disclosure, I must admit to you that this is a chapter with significant sex talk. I do not make apology for that. The Bible is open. It gives full disclosure about every aspect of human life that's been created by God. Trying to get people to think right about sex is no small task. As one man said, in a fallen world, we are trying to keep couples out of bed before marriage and get them back into bed after marriage because of the challenges in the arena of sexuality. The church at Corinth had a lot of questions, a lot of problems, including some in the arena of human relationships and marriage. So they sent some questions to the apostle via some messengers. And the seventh chapter of 1 Corinthians answers the questions that were sent to him, and it gives some rather specific answers to these questions about marital relationships. I'm going to answer just two of them tonight, and here is the first. What is the purpose of sex? What is the purpose of sex? Now, again, if I'm honest, some people think of sex as being gross. That's just their mindset. They think of their body as being gross or everything beneath their neck as being gross because of something that's happened in their life. Many women, especially who've been abused or perhaps who have grown up in non-functional or dysfunctional homes, have a crazy notion about sex being dirty or awful, and they struggle in this particular arena. When my wife Karen and I ministered in northern Kentucky in Covington, we took several trips down to visit a restored community, a Shaker community in a town called Pleasant Hill. It's not far away from Lexington, about 25 miles southwest in the bluegrass country, the horse fence country. You'll see a picture here on the screen of this restored community, the Shaker community from Pleasant Hill. You'll see the white horse fences, about 3,000 acres there. The Shakers were a group not unlike the Amish in that they're communal in living, or at least they were. And yet they're unlike the Amish in that they were very mystical oriented, believing in visions and dreams and trances. And they'd get a word from the Lord, and they would dance around in ecstatic utterances, communicating to their people various messages. But they worked hard. They worked communally. But eventually, they became extinct. There's a reason why they became extinct. They didn't believe in sex. You can laugh there, but it's true. They were completely celibate. And so they eventually died off. I mean, duh. I'm happy to say that Sailorville does not have that problem. We are reproducing in record numbers, at least the Nemers family is.
My point is that many women and some men see sex as gross. There's an opposite aberration. Other people, especially men, see sex as God. That's what they live for. That's what they're all about. Just trying to pleasure themselves, whatever it takes. They're extremely selfish people, and they see sex as God. But sex is not gross, and sex is not God. Sex is a gift from God. God invented the idea. God is the one who came up with sexuality. It's a good thing. It's a blessed thing within the context of marriage. And Paul spoke about this in chapter 7 in verses 1 and 2. Let me, before I begin to read, just explain to you that Paul addresses a number of questions in this chapter. It's a long chapter. Implied to the questions, should we all as Christians be celibate? I mean, is sexuality a good thing? What's the relationship of a husband and a wife in this arena of sexuality? If you're becoming a believer, should you divorce your unsaved mate? If you have been divorced or if you've lost your mate by death, do you have a right to get remarried? Later on in the chapter, the question is, are there any grounds for divorce and any grounds for remarriage? And Paul answers all these questions in this chapter. I don't have time to address all of them tonight, but I want to read verses 1 and 2 as I begin, where you see the implication here. Now, concerning the matters about which you wrote, there's the implication that they'd sent him questions. And he answers a question that obviously came. It is good for a man not to have sexual relations with a woman. He's saying, yeah, it's okay for people to be celibate, to be single. That's good. Sometimes in our society, we look down on people who are single as if somehow that's inferior. No, it's not inferior at all. God gives that gift to some people, and it's as much a blessing as it is to be married. But he acknowledges, because of our human nature, because of the temptation to sexual immorality, each man should have his own wife, and each woman should have her own husband. Now, if you jump over to verses 8 and 9, Paul elaborates a bit more when he says to the unmarried, and in context, he's talking about the divorced. And to the widows, I say, it's good for them to remain single as I am. Paul was single. Now, I personally believe at one time Paul was married because he was a Pharisee. And to be a Pharisee, you had to be married. So I'm guessing that Paul lost his wife someplace along the line, and he was a widower. No place in Scripture does it speak to that, but that's the implication of Scripture. He says, hey, you don't have to get remarried. If you've lost your mate or if you've been divorced, you can stay single as I am. That would be great. But he acknowledges in verse 9, if they cannot exercise self-control, they should marry. He's talking about sexual self-control. For it's better to marry than to burn with passion. So he's saying sex is a gift. Now, it goes without saying to all of you here that it's one of the best gifts he's given to the human race. God has made us sexual beings. He has created us for intimacy. And there comes a time in every young man's life when he has an epiphany. You know, when he's in elementary school, he thinks girls are gross. And then all of a sudden, something happens hormonally, and he reaches that magical age where he begins to change, puberty, you know, middle school, maybe junior high, and he goes through this metamorphosis of thought, and he begins to think, wow, look at those beautiful creatures. I've got to get me one of those. And eventually he does. I'm sure that when Adam woke up from his sweet dream in Genesis chapter 2 and saw Eve standing there, they were both naked and unashamed, he said, wow, Eureka. She is not like any of those animals I named. She's like me, and she is drop-dead gorgeous. And I have to confess to you that when I was a student at Faith here in Ankeny a few years ago, I was a junior and I was looking for a wife, pastoral ministry major, looking for a pastor's wife. And my lovely wife to be, Karen, came on campus. Her dad was a prop of Iowa State. And I had heard before she came on campus that a beauty queen was arriving on campus. She had won the Ideal Miss, which was the teenage division of the Miss Iowa contest in Iowa. And she had won that contest and later on competed in Waco, Texas. And so I knew she was going to be beautiful. But when I found out that she was not only good looking, but she was godly, well, I clutched onto her and I wouldn't let go. And eventually we got engaged over here at Camp Sunnyside. That's true. I went on the grounds there and that's where I proposed to her. And we got married, and I love my wife very, very much. And I got to think that Adam felt that same way. I mean, God took a rib from Adam and produced Eve. And this was amazing. God created her. He named her. He brought her to Adam. Talk about a whirlwind romance. In the same day, she got made and she got married. Big day. Big day for Eve. Now, it's one of the reasons God designed marriage. Sex is a gift with several different rewards. Let me flash on the screen the rewards of sexuality as per Scripture. Sex is for oneness. Sex is for children. Remember that in a selfish society. Sex is for knowledge. We're going to be talking about intimacy tonight. Sex is for pleasure. There's a whole book in the Bible written about sexual pleasure within holy matrimony, within marriage. Sex is for comfort. Sex is for protection, as per our text tonight. But in all of this, sex is to be contained and restrained within the confines of marriage. I don't need to tell you that we live in a day of rampant immorality. Anymore, it's almost assumed that couples are living together, cohabiting. It's happening with increasing frequency, even in the body of Christ, God forbid. I'll be honest with you, when couples come in for premarital counseling, I point blank ask them, are you guys having sex? If they say yes, I say, you must repent and call this sin and stop this, or we will not marry you. We're that serious about it. God has rights and wrongs, moral absolutes, and this is one of them. Now understand that God is not a cosmic killjoy. God's the one who invented sex. God does not leave the bedroom when a husband and a wife get together and say, "Ooh, I can't look at that." He's the one who invented it. He's the one who made us this way. He blesses it. He honors it in marriage. And listen to me. People who are monogamous in a marital relationship have longer sex lives and better sex lives than those who step outside of God's boundaries. Mark it down. Number two question implied in our text, why is sexual dysfunction so common? Before I read verses 3-5, let me just say this about young men in our society. So many young men are on Viagra, and you'd be surprised how many are, because they have been promiscuous in their relationships. The greatest sex organ is the brain, and when they mess around sexually, they mess with their head and they mess with their heart, and so they need help because they haven't gone according to God's plan for keeping sex pure within marriage. That can change by God's grace as we follow His directives. Now, look with me at verses 3-5, back in chapter 7 again, beginning verse 3. The husband should give to his wife her conjugal or sexual rights, and likewise the wife to her husband. In other words, don't punish your mate by withholding sex. For the wife does not have authority over her own body, but the husband does. Likewise, the husband does not have authority over his own body, but the wife does. Do not deprive one another,
except perhaps by agreement for a limited time, that you may devote yourselves to prayer. But notice the caveat, but then come together again so that Satan may not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. For married people, sex is a barometer, it's not a thermostat. It's reported that we may be getting some weather coming in tonight or tomorrow, and likely the barometer will go down. It will indicate what's going on in the atmosphere. That's what sex is in a marriage. It's only a barometer of every other aspect of your marriage. It reflects on how things are going. It reflects on your intimacy factor. Intimacy is one of the great purposes for marriage, and yet it's one of the most obviously ignored aspects of our interpersonal marital relationships. In fact, let me read you a quote from David Powlinson. He states, "When you think about it, you'll notice that the way you treat your spouse reflects the way you treat God. The same things that cause distance in your relationship with God cause distance in your relationship with your spouse." Now, I am constantly counseling, and most of my counseling here at Sederville is marriage counseling. And when I counsel, I'm constantly reading body language. There are three postures maritally that I see, and I'm speaking figuratively now, three postures I observe in couples that are struggling with each other. The first posture is back to back, which, if you will, pictures animosity. The next posture is side by side, which at best pictures perhaps civility. And the best in biblical posture is face to face, which pictures intimacy. In a distant marriage, people live on parallel tracks, but they're not facing each other. They're just kind of doing life alongside of one another in their busyness, you know, with work and kids in school and sports activities, and they're not really intimate with each other, not in the sense of being involved in each other's souls. And so while they're on parallel tracks, they never intersect. They never get into a deeper relationship that goes beyond the superficial. Sex is not just physical, it's also deeply spiritual and relational. And that's why when Adam and Eve sinned, they went into hiding sexually as well as spiritually. And my take on this is that guys, in large part, have been on the run from intimacy ever since the fall. Ever since Adam stepped back into the shadows and let Eve deal with Satan on her own. He should have been there. He should have manned up. He should have been the spiritual leader, but he let her take the hit. Adam sinned first in allowing Eve to have access to the enemy instead of protecting her. Adam's fear has afflicted us all. And our corporate shame over not protecting our wives has kept us from being spiritual leaders. And frankly, what's happened, we see it all over the place. Women step into the void or the vacuum of the man stepping into the shadows, and she becomes the de facto spiritual leader, which is not God's design. Guys, I want to beg you, man up. Be the spiritual leader in the home your wife longs you to be. I know it's hard. She'll help you. We'll help you. But man up and be the man of God that he's called you to be in the Word of God. More on that next week. But back to verses 3 through 5 and to the interpretation of these verses. Why would a husband and a wife agree to abstain from relations for a period of time? Now, ostensibly, the text seems to imply it's for spiritual reasons, and maybe that's the correct interpretation. Maybe it's a kind of super spiritual prayer summit. But could it be, I'm going to interject this, could it be the text implies that any given couple at Corinth was having trouble communicating, and thus they were praying alone for resolution. Lord, show me what to do in this situation. I'm struggling. I want to get back with my mate, and I don't know how to make it happen. Remember, Paul was writing to a church. It was very dysfunctional and likely had many homes that were very dysfunctional. My experience in counseling is that couples sexually withdraw or abstain because they're upset with each other, not because usually they want to fast and pray to get closer to God. Again, their posture implies a posture more like back-to-back than face-to-face, more adversarial than it really is intimate. And body language, I think, tells all. Couples in trouble will not look each other in the eye. Observe body language. Couples in trouble will not look each other in the eyes because the eyes are the window to the soul. When I talk to my wife, when she talks to me, she asks me to look at her, eyes to eyes, connecting. The soul comes through the eyes, and we have to look at our mates when we're talking to them. Eye contact requires honesty and openness. Couples, don't be given to secrecy. Talk about what's going on deep in your soul. That's where intimacy comes from. Secrecy is to sickness what openness is to health. Secrecy is to sickness what openness is to health. You have to be honest. You have to be open. You've got to talk and share what's deep in your soul. And those who will not look at their mates are the very ones who are most tempted to have an affair. Look at the last phrase of verse 5 again in our text. Paul says, come back together so that Satan may not tempt you because of your lack of self-control. If you're not together for a while, you're going to be tempted. Now listen to me. Affairs almost always start emotionally. The couple is not talking, they're not intimate. A person of the opposite sex comes along, listens to one of the mates, and then starts to affirm them, and they start to emotionally bond. And if the husband and the wife do not reconcile, the temptation to commit adultery intensifies. If the guy doesn't sin physically with a friend or a co-worker, he will sin with porn. If a wife doesn't sin physically with a friend or a co-worker, she sins vicariously through a book or a chat room or on Facebook. Now, let me just interject here at this point. We all know some people who or in a relationship where the husband or the wife has been unfaithful. Don't be quick to judge the innocent one as if they are guilty of a lack of intimacy. Sometimes it's just the hard heart of a husband or a wife who goes astray, and it's not really at the fault of their mate. But frequently there are issues on both sides that come into play. The trouble usually traces back to an inability to communicate intimately. An author friend of mine, Dr. Steve Scheibner, shares the warning of expectations that are left unexpressed, and he explains it this way. He says, most couples play a little game with their expectations called, if you loved me, you would know game. And he goes on. He says, in this game, they build an expectation for their spouse to guess. Their assumption is that the other person will somehow read their mind and do what is necessary to meet their expectation. And he says there are three unwritten rules in the expectation game. Now, no, he's speaking tongue-in-cheek here, okay? Here's the first unwritten rule. Never communicate out loud the expectation you have of the other person. They should just know. After all, if they loved you, they would know. Number two, become highly reactive and totally offended when your expectation is not met. Remember, they should have known. After all, if they loved you, they would know. Or number three, make sure the other person pays dearly for not meeting your felt need. Throw them under the bus as often as possible. so that the next time they will work harder to meet your expectations. After all, if they loved you, they would know. We live life a lot that way. Of course, this is foolish talking, this expectation game. The point is you need to communicate and communicate expectations, including sexual expectations. Don't assume anything. Talk. Get it out there. It takes work. Paul admits that even the best of marriages take work. Look later in the chapter at verse 28, the last phrase, 28. Yet those who marry will have worldly troubles. That includes everybody here, including the guy talking. Everybody has marital challenges. Now he said, I would spare you that. That's why it may be better to be single. Most of us are married, so we've got to work through issues. It takes work. Every person has to work at their marriage, whether you've been married for 5 years or 50 years. You've got to work at marriage. If you're married here tonight, you raised your hand earlier, would you all say the word work in unison? Work. Say it again. Work. Say it again. Work. Same principle Pastor Pat talked about when you have dry seasons in the Word, you push through it. Same thing is true in your marriage. You remove the D word from your vocabulary. We're not going to divorce. It's not an option. It's not on the table. We're going to push through this. We're going to work through this by the power of God's word and by the grace of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ. We're going to work at it. Every married person has to do that. You cannot ignore your marriage. You cannot simply assume in marriage. And get this, among human relationships, if you are married, there is only one primary relationship, and that is your marital relationship. Your children are a secondary relationship. Your parents are a secondary relationship. Your sibling are a secondary relationship. Your work associate are a secondary relationship. You only have one primary relationship in your life, and that's your marriage. That means, moms, you don't put the kids before your husband. And guys, you don't put your work ahead of your wife. Or after a while, she'll say you have a mistress, and it's called your work, and that can lead to the destruction of a marriage. Primary relationship is your marriage. Now, if you're going to do that, you've got to prioritize your marriage. You need a 3D marriage. What's a 3D marriage? Well, here it is. First of all, you've got to dialogue daily. You've got to talk. I want to urge you, I want to challenge you to carve out at least 20 minutes every day to talk back and forth. Dialogue daily. Ask each other three questions, simple questions. What are your burdens today? What's your low point been? Let her talk. And then repeat back what she said, and let him talk, and then repeat back what he said. And then ask a second question, what are your joys today? What was a highlight of your day? Again, both partners talk. And then thirdly, what are your aspirations for tomorrow? Or here early in the year, you could say, what are your aspirations for the rest of 2015 in our marriage, in our relationship, in our kids, in our life? Spiritually, what are your aspirations? Now, here's where we sometimes get stuck, because one of the partners wants to move forward and the other one doesn't. What do we do when one wants to move forward and the other doesn't? The one who wants to must keep on loving the same way that Jesus loves us, with perseverance. Even when we go through dry seasons, he keeps on loving us. He will never let us go. We can never be separated from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord, Romans chapter 8. And beware of this, though I'm talking about intimacy tonight, don't turn intimacy into an idol. Your husband, your wife can never be Christ to you. Only Christ can be Christ to you. And God doesn't guarantee that all of us will have A or A minus marriages. Some of you are going to have a C plus marriage. Some of you are going to have a D minus marriage. But you still can rejoice in who you are in Christ and use this as a platform to show others that Jesus completely satisfies no matter what's going on at home. You're focused on Christ, and he's the one who gives you joy. Don't turn intimacy into an idol. Dialogue daily. Then secondly, you must date weekly. Get away from the home, get a babysitter, whatever. Doesn't need to cost a lot of money, but date weekly. Invest some time into your partner. And then thirdly, depart quarterly. Get away for a weekend. Just spend some one-on-one time for a longer period of time. It'll do wonders for your romance. If you don't do that, you're likely to experience a lot of frustration. And what is frustration? Well, here's Kevin Lehman's definition of frustration. Frustration is the distance between expectation and reality. You live in a real world. You live with a sinner. And when sinners say, "I do," they understand that they have to apply the cross to their own relationship and their own heart every day. You've got to work at romance. About 6-8 months ago, my wife brought home a little plaque from Kohl's that says, "Love you more." Maybe you've got this in your home. Do you know what we do with this? We play with this. We have a game with this. We're constantly using this. I'll hide it, then she'll hide it. I'll hide it, then she'll hide it. And I've hid it in all kinds of places. I've hid this in the shower. I've hid this under her pillow. I've hid this in her drawers. I've hid it in the refrigerator. I want to surprise her that says, "I love you more." And then she'll hide it for me, and then I'll discover it. So we go back and forth. Love you more, love you more, love you more, love you more. You know what we're doing? We're racing each other to the cross. We're dying to ourselves and saying, "I want to love you more. I want to love you the way Jesus loved me, by giving it my all." And that keeps romance alive in our marriage. That next June will be 40 years. And I thank God for my wife, and I thank God for the gift of marriage. By the way, if you want to pick one of these up, Karen said there's more at Kohl's, okay? Tell them I recommended, maybe they'll give you a discount. I don't know. My time is just about up. Next week, I want to talk to you about the differences between men and women, which are significant, and how we work through that challenge by God's grace, according to the next two passages we're going to look at. And let me just say this. If you come for counseling, you probably heard me use this illustration. Everybody here tonight carries with them two buckets. And one of those buckets is a bucket of gas, and the other one is a bucket of water. And when a potential conflict arises, causing a spark between the two of you because of friction, you choose which bucket you're going to dump on the spark. You are responsible for which bucket you put on the spark. "I can't help myself. She just makes me go wild." No, you're responsible for your own decisions. Nobody makes you do nothing. It comes from your own heart, from your own sinful desires, James chapter 4. You need to take responsibility for the decisions you make. It takes two to fight, okay? So let's show love, and let's throw a bucket of water, not a bucket of gas, on a spark of controversy. You picked up a handout tonight as you shook hands earlier. I want you to pull that out if you would. If you come in for counseling, you know that I always give you homework, and so I'm going to give everybody here tonight some homework. I want you to take this and use this with your husband or your wife, maybe parents with your children, maybe siblings, brother or sister. Communication guidelines, all these are based on Scripture, as per Norman Wright and communication guidelines, as you see at the bottom. The verses upon which these are framed are to the far right. I'm just going to walk through them quickly, and then I want you to go home, and I want you to discuss these with your mate. Now, one of the things we do in church world is we become professional listeners. We say, that's good, that's good. And we go home and we watch television or we go through a week and we don't apply. If you're going to grow in Christ, you got to get into the Word and you got to apply biblical principles. So I'm challenging you to go home and talk this over with a mate or a friend or whatever you have a relationship, communication guidelines, talk it through. Number one, be a ready listener and do not answer until the other person has finished talking. And don't be trying to load your own gun while they're shooting at you. Listen, and then repeat what they say. Number two, be slow to speak. Scripture says that. Be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. Think first, don't be hasty in your words. Speak in such a way that the other person can understand and accept what you say. Speak the truth always, but do it in love. Do not exaggerate the you always or you never. Number four, do not use silence to frustrate the other person. Now, if you need a little time, ask for a timeout, but then come back and talk it through. Don't just ignore them. Don't just walk away. Don't leave a cloud hanging over them. Come back and talk it through. Explain why you're hesitant to talk at this time. Five, do not become involved in quarrels. It's possible to disagree without quarreling. You can learn to agree to disagree agreeably. Number six, do not respond in anger. Use a soft and kind response. Your inflection, how you say things comes into play here. Seven, when you are in the wrong, admit it and ask for forgiveness. And by the way, the right way to apologize is not to say, well, if I did something wrong, I'm sorry. That's not an apology. You need to name your sin and say, I sinned against you with my anger. By my mean-spirited words, will you please forgive me? You give them a chance to respond to your genuine apology. When someone confesses to you, tell them you forgive them. Be sure it's forgotten and not brought up to the person. Number eight, avoid nagging. Nine, do not blame or criticize the other person. Even when they're attacking you, you don't have to return in kind. Instead, restore, encourage, edify. If someone verbally attacks, criticizes, or blames you, do not respond in the same manner. And finally, try to understand the other person's opinion. Make allowances for differences. Be concerned about their interests. Okay, you have your homework assignment. I'm begging of you. Work on it. Talk to each other. Guys, don't pull rank. Don't be proud as a peacock. Listen to her. Listen to her heart. Ladies, respect him. Affirm him. I know he's got a long way to go. I know I do. But we're all people in need of change, trying to help others in need of change. That's what I am as a counselor, a biblical counselor, a person in need of change, trying to help people in need of change. And we all know the great changer whose name is Jesus Christ. So let's follow his principles for marriage and we'll be blessed. Father, as Pastor Pat comes to close the service, I pray that you'll help all of us to take to heart and not just blow this off, but to go home, talk this through. And get beyond the superficial, get beyond watching television, talking small talk, but really getting into root and heart issues of where people are living and their hurts, and help us to be intimate. And we know that when we're intimate in our souls and our spirits, then we'll eventually be intimate physically as well, as is your plan. Please do what I cannot do by applying your word by your spirit, I pray in Christ's name. Amen.